famed Economic Recovery and Resilience. The 2021 budget presentation began at 11 a.m. at the National Assembly Complex in Abuja. Addressing members of the Senate and House of Representatives, President Muhammadu Buhari says the 2021 budget would build on the gains of the 2020 budget, including job creation and economic stability. He highlights the details of the proposed expenditure.
An aggregate expenditure of 13.08 trillion naira is proposed for the federal government in 2021. This includes 1.35 trillion naira spending by government-owned enterprises and grants and aid-funded expenditures of 354.85 billion naira. For 2021, the proposed 13.08 trillion naira expenditure comprises a non-debt recurrent cost of 5.65 trillion naira, b personal costs of 3.76 trillion naira, c pensions, gratuities, and retirees' benefits of 500.19 billion naira, d overheads of 625.5 billion naira, e debt service of 3.124 trillion naira, debt service of 3.124 trillion naira, f statutory transfers 484.49 billion naira. G, sinking fund of 220 billion naira to retire certain maturing bonds.
The president also notes the high cost on personnel, which remains the largest single item on the expenditure list.
In 7 months, the 31st July 2020, it accounted for 34% of total federal government spending and is projected at 33% of 2021 expenditure.
To check payment to non-existent personnel and unauthorized allowances, he said only federal government staff on the Integrated Personnel Payroll Information System, IPPIS, would receive salaries. The president asked Nigerians to note the revenue generated for the 2021 budget and not just on its expenditure.
Oil revenue is projected at 2.01 trillion naira. Non-oil revenue is estimated at 1.49 trillion naira. As you will observe, the format of the 2021 appropriation bill has been modified to include budgeted revenues, no matter how small, for each MDA, that's a ministry, departments, and agencies, to focus on internal revenue generation. Accordingly, I implore you to pay as much attention to the revenue side as you do to the expenditure side.
The president also notes the high cost on personnel. Before the president's budget presentation, President of the Senate, Ahmed Lawan, assures Nigerians that the National Assembly is prepared to pass the 2021 appropriation bill before the end of 2020.
Welcome back. It's still Plus Politics, and we are still looking at the budget that was presented by President Muhammadu Buhari earlier today. And we still have our guest with us, Mokhtar Mohammed, a financial analyst, and sometimes we refer to him as an economist. Anyone is okay. Good evening once again, Mokhtar. I hope you're back now.
Good evening. I'm back.
Yeah, good. Yeah. We just listened to that report put together by Aneta, and she highlighted, the report highlighted quite a lot of issues, and that's one of the things we want to look at. The president's insistence of only paying the lecturers in the IPPIS platform. And we expect that the national president of ASUU will join us in this conversation. We've been trying to reach out to him, but he's here to pick our call. But in the interim, let's look at that. This issue has been lingering, and the president had to mention it in this budget. What does that suggest? That seems like the president is adamant that it's either IPPIS or nothing. What do you think the lecturers stand to lose with this decision?
I don't think the lecturers stand to lose anything in the long run. I think it's the student that will suffer because the lecturers will want to embark on strikes and whatever the president says. Look, the lecturers are saying we are not against the IPPIS platform, but we have our own type of platform also that we want to use. That's what the lecturers seems to be saying, because they're saying that IPPIS does not capture a lot of things that have to do with them. They go on sabbatical, their retirement age is 70. They came out with a lot of things that they think, I think that the government should look, and they even volunteered to prepare something as similar as the IPPI that the government should be using, that they think is better. And they said the vice chancellor of the University of Port Harcourt even volunteered to do it for the government for free. So when you look at that, that's about the government insisting on having their own way, then it's like two elephants are fighting and the grass will suffer. So for me, the basic thing the government is looking at is that IPPI have saved us a lot of money in terms of goods workers. And sometimes you even ask the workers in the civil service, they are also complaining about some deductions that have been going out of their account because of the IPPI system. So if I'm in that kind of situation, I hear what people are saying about it, will I want to be part of that cap? And it's not capturing everything that has to do with them. So I think the government should look at it, sit down with us once, look at why do you want this IPPI work? But I think the government is getting it, maybe getting it wrong or right. Maybe they feel that some members of ASUU have already registered, and they think that if those members have registered, it will not be long. The other members will have no option than register and also support it. But if you register and you start having this problem, then we'll go back to where we used to be. And those ones that didn't want to register before, we say, this was what we were talking about. So the government should look at the university as a special project on how to handle them, not necessarily trying to bully the lecturers or trying to make them feel that we dictate the pay. Just today, we're made to understand. So it's more or less like trying to paint them black. Just today, the Minister for State for Education was telling us that the lecturers also about 50 point something percent of the educational budget, is it 50 or almost 70, is being paid to lecturers. I don't think that is fair for you to come out and say that without substantiating it. So for me, I think they should tread cautiously and see how issues could be resolved.
Okay, I need a bit of clarity here. Is the argument as simple as the pro-government proponents put it? The pro-government proponent did say that, why do you want to determine how I will pay you? I'm your employer, and I want to use IPPIS. And you are saying no? Is it that simple? Why should the lecturers say no?
Well, like I told you, your employer is going to pay you. You agreed at a particular amount of money that the employer is going to pay you. And at the end of the month, you are going to receive less than that, not based on what is not taxable, but other things that have been added into the IPPI. That's what the lecturers say. The lecturers are not saying that we don't want the IPPI platform from what I've gathered from them. They also said, look, we want the platform. It's helping the cope of corruption. But what we are saying that it does not capture the peculiarity of our own sectors. That is what they are just saying. Capture it and let's see it work. That's just the challenge. And government is saying, like you just right pointed out, using the argument, you don't tell me how to pay you when I employ you. I don't think it's right.
Because this sounds a bit unpopular to me, because over time, what we've heard is government is trying to stop corruption in the university system or the tertiary institution system. Because we've seen that at Polytechnic, they seem to be playing along with the IPPIS arrangement. But you were saying that it is the IPPIS that will promote corruption, if I'm not misunderstanding you. So, but government is saying we want to block the leakages.
Understanding me, I say, according to the lecturers,
okay,
the IPPI is not capturing everything that has to do with the precarity of their own environment and their own terms of service. That's what they are saying.
Okay.
That's what they said. The present IPPI, as constituted or as implemented, does not capture it. So Once somebody's 65, I mean, when somebody is 60, that means the IPPI will cut them off the payment scheme. That's what the lecturers are, that's what they are clamoring for. Not because they are saying that, oh, we don't want the IPPI. They are saying that our own type of environment, there's a peculiarity with our own type of environment. That's basically what they are saying.
Okay, thank you so much. Let's look at the leakages in our budget system. Let's look at the leakages in terms of corruption and some other forms. For example, the government, obviously, you remember when this administration came up, they were confronted with the Niger Delta Avengers, where we are having so much leakages, pipeline vandalism. But now they can think of 1.8 million, you know, in a day. And that tells you that there is some measure of peace in that region. But what about the TSA? What about the BVN? Are we still using these measures to curb some form of stealings and corruption?
Definitely we are. Of recently, you remember the government came out that most people have to re-register for their BVM, and at the end of the day, it was the wrong information. Actually, what the government is saying that Nigerians that are abroad, or Nigerians that are here, you have businesses abroad, you have to re-register because we want to make sure that you are not using an environment to make money and you are not paying tax. So the BVM is one of these innovative that are really, really work. Unfortunately, in governance, we have a lot of people that are not ready to work because it's the same BVM. You go to capture for BVM, you go to immigration, you go to driver's license, you go to every agency seems to have its own database instead of us having a centralized database. So for me, I think what the government should be working towards is getting this data from the BVM, getting it from the immigration service, getting it from the road safety, bring it together, try to pull them together and make a centralized database. I think if we are able to achieve that, that would be good for us.
Okay, still talking about this system, let's also look at the cost of governance. And by cost of governance, we are also looking at our recurrent expenditure. I know how this current administration has tried to change the narratives that, oh, gonna those days where we have 80% to less than 20% rich ratio in terms of recurrent and that of capital. But now, I think there's been a kind of 70 to 30, getting less than 70. I think it can get better. So how do we get to that El Dorado, I call it El Dorado, where we will have government backing out from, you know, employing people, but rather creating an enabling environment for investors to create jobs?
I thank God you said, when will we get to that El Dorado? And, you know, getting to El Dorado, you need to put a lot of work and assistance now. Not only this government, most government in Nigeria are not ready to get their sleeve off and do their work. They are always looking for shortcut towards delivering their whatever promise they have promised Nigeria. So for me, it's something that the cost of governance, we just said it, where you allocate about 158 billion for the National Assembly alone. That's about cost of governance. And again, this National Assembly, you have the senator, he has his driver has a PA, the senator has a PA, the PA has a PA, and all this type of, even in governance, you see them, they've not even reduced their ways of recklessness. They are still driving with 4 or 5 cars in governor's convoy. So all these are all that cost of governance. For cost of governance to be effective, we must have to start from the political class. And I think that is where the challenge is. None of them want to come in there and implement and bring down the cost of governance because it's more or less like, is this during my time that I will not enjoy? So that's a problem. There's no nationalistic view and there's not a synergy towards achieving that. So if we continue like that, we'll continue to go like that. You don't understand why a budget of a country like Nigeria, we have about 70% of the budget on recurrent expenditure, and you have only 30% for capital expenditure. It's very, very bad.
Okay, so sad that that's the situation. But going forward, because this probably might be my last question because of time, how do we achieve the January-December calendar? Has the executive done well to submit it by this time?
I have my own take when it comes to January, December, because I don't think if you want to achieve January, December, you want to do a thorough work, we should have been seeing the budget sometime in maybe July, August, so that the legislators will have a lot of time to work on it. You are giving it in just 3 months. The president, even in his budget, we said he has ordered all agencies of government, all MDA, to make sure they appear as well. It's not about appearance. It has to do more about coming prepared, answering the questions, because some of these, when they come in there, they are not prepared for the type of question. They just think it's a normal jamboree. When are we going to make budget presentation or budget defend public, whereby you and I can sit down there and look at them, and they will look at the numbers and say, oh, this is it. What are you using it for? Which project was it? Is it tied to? So as long as we continue to play that politics with the budget and politics with the economy, why they rush to make it December? You've already had a doctrine, like I said, they don't know how to set a doctrine of necessity, that even if the budget does not run for the next 6 months, no project will be stranded. Even if I don't agree with that, but it doesn't mean the legislators should not do the right thing. It has been common, it has been proven that these current legislators are the rubber stamp of the president. They have a lot to prove to us, and they should begin to use this budget as one of those times that they will use to prove to Nigeria that they are not just rubber stamp, they have the interest of the Nigerian people at heart.
Since this is PLUS Politics, let me just ask you a political question before you go. I want to put you on the spot. Now, the president said categorically at that presentation that he has ordered his ministers, his aides, and all the barristers not to ignore invitation by the National Assembly that they should come and defend the budget. Do you think that was just a political statement, or is really an order?
The thing about President Buhari is that it's not a political statement, it's an order. But what we've seen about President Buhari is that his orders are not taken seriously by the people, because I can go on and all remember the IG incident to relocate to Benue State. He never did. There are a lot of other orders that have come in and have never been implemented. There's a lot of things. So you don't just give orders if you don't have the political way to implement it. But I'm sure now when it comes to the civil servants, I'm sure there's a lot of places that have to be remembered. We talk about the budget partying. That's why I said make budget presentation, make budget defense a public thing so that everybody will come in there and listen to them. But as long as you make budget presentation, that's inside one corner, inside one room, and the legislators, that's why when they come out from the budget, they will tell you that a budget of 13 point something trillion, that will only have a revenue of something 7 point something, they have actually increased that budget to maybe 12 or 13 point something trillion. And they will be telling, maybe it's 13%, they may have increased it to 16% in trillion, and they'll be telling us that they just fill with bits and bits and bits, and that it's the same National Assemblies that we have that will move a state project into a federal government project and insist that the federal government will have to do so. There's a lot of things that are wrong with our budgeting, and it will take the grace of God for us to get it wrong. As long as we have the current breed of politicians that thinks first of what they have to gain before the people, will continue to have a challenge with the budget.
Thank you so much, Mokhtar Mohammed, for your time. That was quite insightful, and that's to tell you that everybody is a political animal, and you've done justice to the political aspect of this discussion. Thank you so much for your time.
Always a pleasure, Kaede. Do have a pleasant day.
I will. Thank you so much. And I'm afraid this is how far we can go on today's edition of PLUS Politics. PLUS Politics returns tomorrow. And don't also forget that on Saturday, we are also going to open our studio live ahead of that's when the Ondo governorship election will be taking place. Trust me, it's going to be quite interesting, quite insightful. The station to watch as PLUS TV Africa. This is where we sign off on behalf of the production crew, the man behind the camera, and the men behind, some ladies are going to give me a big slap, and the ladies behind the council, they've done so well. Thank you so much. Let's do it again tomorrow, same time, on the same station. I remain yours truly, Kayode Ladeinde, saying bye for now.